Thank you very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen. And thank you, Princess Mabel. How are you, ladies and gentlemen? This is Africa. How are you? Wonderful. Do you know the person next to you? Do you know the person on the other side of you? We greet in Africa. Welcome to Durban and welcome to Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great privilege and an honor to be here. It's the start of a busy conference with many stresses and demands and anguishes. And I want to start by asking us to pause for a few moments. It's been 35 years since the world was alerted to AIDS. The first cases of a baffling, new, terrifying, unknown syndrome were first reported in the summer of 1981. These last 35 years, for many of us, it's been an exhausting and arduous and often dismaying journey. We felt the burden of this terrible disease in our bodies, on our minds, on our friends and our loved ones, and on our communities. AIDS exposes us in all our terrible human vulnerability. It brings to the fore our fears and prejudices. It takes its toll on our bodily organs and our muscles and our flesh. It has exacted its terrible toll on our brothers and sisters and parents and colleagues. So we pause first, ladies and gentlemen, in remembrance of those who have died. Those for whom treatment didn't come in time. Those for whom treatment wasn't available or accessible. Those denied treatment by our own failings as planners and thinkers and doers and actors. Those for whom the internal nightmare of internalized stigma and shame put them beyond reach behind the wall of stigma and fear. These years of grief have demanded great sacrifices of too many of us. But it's also been a journey of light. And we must pause then second to celebrate. Sorry, ladies and gentlemen, I'm getting used to this. We must pause to celebrate the triumphs of medicine, science, activism, healthcare, professional dedication, and infrastructure that have brought ALVs to so many millions. Indeed, the fact that I'm here today is a tribute to those triumphs of science and activism. I want to say, ladies and gentlemen, that many of you here present were responsible for the breakthroughs that led to the combination of antiretroviral treatment that I started on nearly 19 years ago. And I claim no credit and seek no praise for surviving. It felt like a necessary task. All of us here today, taking ARVs, let us put our hands up. All of us here today, taking ARVs, let us humble our heads in acknowledgement of our privilege and often plain luck in getting treatment on time. That treatment has given us life. And then let us pause third to honor the doctors and the scientists and the researchers, the wise physicians and strong counselors who have saved lives and healed populations in this epidemic. We pause for them too. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, and as importantly, we pause to honor the activists, those whose work made treatment available, as the previous speakers, Dr. Cortina, have explained, to those who would not otherwise have received it. We pause to honor the part in particular in treatment availability and access of angry, principled, determined activists in South Africa's Treatment Action Campaign and elsewhere. Without their courage, strategic skill and passion, medication would have remained unimaginably expensive, out of reach to most people with HIV. On Thursday night, ladies and gentlemen, an important event takes place. There will be a concert which is a fundraiser for the Treatment Action Campaign, which faces closure because of lack of funds. You can show how you honor history and honour the role of activists by supporting that concert on Thursday evening. Those activists, ladies and gentlemen, taught us an important lesson. Solidarity and support are not enough. Knowledge and insight are not enough. To save lives, we need more. We need action. We need enraged, committed, principled, strategic, ingenious action. They refused to acquiesce in a howling moral outrage. This was the notion that life-saving treatment that was available, that could be manufactured cheaply, would not be given to poor people, mostly black poor people, because of laws protecting intellectual property and patent holders' profits. The Treatment Action Campaign took that notion on, and it won. What is more, without the Treatment Action Campaign, President Mbeki's nightmare flirtation with AIDS denialism would never have been defeated. They took to the streets in protest. They demanded treatment for all. And when President Mbeki proved obdurate, they took to the streets. And because of our country's beautiful constitution, they won an important victory. Government was ordered to start making antiretroviral treatment available by the Constitutional Court. I was not a member of it then. The results, as you've heard today, ladies and gentlemen, is that my country today has the world's largest publicly provided treatment, antiretroviral treatment provision program. So, ladies and gentlemen, in the sad history of this epidemic, the triumphs of eight activists on five continents are a light point of joy. But we must not continue without remembering that AIDS inflicts a staggering cost on this continent and our world. What is more important than my survival and that of many millions of people, the 70 million on antiretroviral treatment that Dr. Cortino mentioned, is that many people are still not receiving it. There still remains so much that should be done. There still remains so much that can be done. Too many people are still denied antiretroviral treatment. Worse, the pattern of antiretroviral treatment availability is one that reflects our own weaknesses and vices as humans, our prejudices and our hatreds and our fears, our selfish claiming for ourselves what we do not grant to others. Most of those still in need of antiretroviral treatment are poor, marginalized, and stigmatized. Stigmatized by poverty, sexual orientation, gender identity, by the work they do, by their drug taking and by being in prison. Stigmatized by our criminal laws. Dr. Jonathan Mann, to whom this lecture is dedicated, saw that. He recognized that the perils of HIV are enormously increased by laws that specifically criminalize its transmission and exposure of another to it. This was confirmed by the Global Commission on HIV and the Law, the important work it's recently done. Laws that criminalize those of us with HIV, ladies and gentlemen, are vicious, misguided, and evil. They are often intolerably overbroad. By criminalizing exposure, they ignore the science of AIDS, which shows how difficult it is to transmit AIDS. HIV, and I don't want to mention just Zimbabwe here, ladies and gentlemen. The Supreme Court of Canada, in its decision in Mabel, made a person who has intercourse on fully suppressed antiretroviral treatment without disclosing it guilty of rape. That's in Canada, so I ask all the Canadians to share the blame, not just us in Africa. I like being asked to the Canadians. Ladies and gentlemen, across this beautiful continent of Africa, men who have sex with men remain chronically underserved. They lack programs in awareness, education, outreach, condom provision, and access to ARVs. That is a study by Professor Chris Byra, who's the co-chair of this conference, that shows how, despite the knowledge and the means, we are still failing men who have sex with men across the world, and particularly in Africa. For this, there is one reason only: ignorance, prejudice, hatred, and fear. world has not yet accepted diversity of gender and gender identity and sexual orientation as a natural and joyful fact of being human. It is a shameful state of affairs. As a proudly and openly gay man, I have experienced the sting of ostracism, of ignorance and hatred. But I have also experienced the power of redeeming love and acceptance and exclusiveness. Ladies and gentlemen, we do not ask for tolerance. We do not ask for acceptance. We claim what is rightfully ours. That is our right to be ourselves in dignity and equality with other human beings. We claim our right to be human. Discrimination on the ground of sexual orientation or gender identity is a colossal waste of time. And the sooner we accept our differences, the better for all of us in Africa. Look at those wonderful quotes from our wonderful Archbishop Tutu. He said, ladies and gentlemen, at the launch of the UN AIDS, the UNDP, UN Organization Free and Equal Campaign, I don't want to go to a heaven in which there's a homophobic God. If I get there and he tells me he's homophobic, I will say to him, no, I want to go to the other place. Ladies and gentlemen, the same applies to sex workers. Sex workers are perhaps the most reviled group in human history, indispensable to a portion of mostly heterosexual males in any society, but despised, marginalized, persecuted, and ostracized. Sex workers work. Their work is work with dignity. Why do sex workers do sex work? Ask a sex worker for groceries, for school fees, to feed their children, to send money to their relatives in the rural areas. Don't you all want to do that, ladies and gentlemen? Princess Mabel, don't you want to do that? It's hard work, ladies and gentlemen. It's perilous work. They have a tough, dangerous job. They deserve our love and respect and support, not our contempt and condemnation. They deserve police protection, not exploitation and assault and humiliation. Most important of all, they deserve access to pre-exposure prophylaxis, which we've heard about this morning. And I'm proud that my country has been one of the first to conform with the objective of offering all sex workers pre-exposure prophylaxis. Criminalizing sex work, ladies and gentlemen, is a profound evil and a distraction from the more important work of building a humane society. Especially vulnerable, too, are people who use injecting drugs. Upon them are visited the vicious consequences of perhaps the most colossal public policy mistake of the last century, the war on drugs. They are denied elementary life-saving services. This is not, ladies and gentlemen, on the supposedly dark continent of Africa. If you want to see an example of public policy that ignores evidence, that is denialist in the face of what we know must be done, don't come here, don't come in history to President Mbeki's AIDS denialism. Look at the federal government of the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, we know exactly what we have to do to tame this epidemic. We have to empower young people, as we've just heard from Dr. Patino and from the other speakers today, especially young girls. We have to empower them to make health-seeking choices. We have to redouble our prevention and education efforts. And second, ladies and gentlemen, we have to test. We cannot promote consensual testing enough. It's the gateway to knowledge, power, understanding, and action. Without testing, there can be no access to treatment. The more we test, the more we know, and the more we can do. It must always be with the consent of the person tested, but we have to be careful that we do not impose unnecessarily burdensome requirements on testing. HIV, now fully medically manageable, should be able to be consented to in testing, should be capable of being implied and being inferred. We must remove barriers to self-testing. I speak of this with passion, ladies and gentlemen, because by making it more difficult for health workers to test, we increase the stigma and fear surrounding HIV. Gone are the terrible days when testing was only a gateway to ostracism, the loss of benefits and stigma. And in all of this, we have to be attentive to the large, understated, underexplored, under-researched epidemic issue, which is the issue of internalized stigma. It's the effect of the outside experience of ostracism, discrimination, hatred, and prejudice on our own minds. I experienced that, ladies and gentlemen. The worst experience of being diagnosed with HIV was the sense of internal shame and pollution and contamination and disgrace that I felt. Internalized stigma has its source in the outside, but they are important to the minds, the very recesses of consciousness of many of us with HIV and those at risk of it. Located deeply within the self, self-blame, self-stigma, and self-paralyzing fear are all too deadly. We must talk about this and find solutions to it. And most important of all, as Stephanie said in her opening, and as my comrade and friend Mark Haywood has recently written, we must look at the societal context in which AIDS is transmitted and in which it makes people sick and causes them to die. We have medically tamed AIDS, but we have not tamed the social and political determinants of HIV, particularly the overlapping inequalities on which it thrives. Gender, education, access to healthcare, access to justice. And that is why prevention strategies are not succeeding. A better response to HIV, as Mark Haywood rightly notes, needs a better world. Governments must deliver on their human rights obligations. Activists and scientists must join struggles for meaningful democracy, for gender equality, and for social justice. But to end, ladies and gentlemen, I want to return to the light points in our struggle against the effects of this disease over the last 30 years. I want to celebrate the fact that Professor Strathbee pointed out this morning that we are in a position to eliminate mother-to-child transmission, again because of the activists. We know how effectively antiretroviral treatment protects babies during birth and after birth. I'm proud of what my country has achieved there. I'm proud that Cuba became the first country to achieve 100% elimination of mother-to-child transmission. A second light point, ladies and gentlemen, a wonderful light point, is that we didn't know in the middle of that nightmare of AIDS denialism, when we feared toxicity, we feared drug-up reactions, we feared non-adherence, we feared drug reactions, we didn't know how wonderfully successful antiretroviral treatment would be in the pediatrics setting. We didn't know how well it would work with young people. In this uncertainty, we now know triumphantly that ARVs work wonderfully and beautifully for children born with ARVs. On ARVs. And I want to rejoice in the beauty and vigor of my godson, Andy Morobi. Andy and I became family in 2004 when he was 10 years old. And he was not on antiretroviral therapy. Who's this handsome man here?
Yes. You look like Andy Morobi.
Because I am Andy Morobi.
You are Andy Morobi. Aren't these people beautiful?
Yes, they are. You guys are looking awesome, thank you. I want to thank all of you for coming out here, and I want to thank my friends and family for supporting me through this. I believe in leading by an example. As a future young leader, I want us to come out of the closet about our HIV status. I know we fear rejection, but let them love us for who we are, not what we have. As Ms. Stefani said, silence equals to death. So thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to let Andy go. I want to ask him, Andy, what was it like to know when you were a toddler that you were living with HIV, that you were born with HIV, that you were orphaned by this terrible epidemic?
It came as a shock, honestly speaking, because I lost a younger sister and a mom due to this virus, and I survived. So it's an honor to actually be standing in front of all of you here. And thank you for the treatment. Thank you for each and everyone who took part in that march. And yeah, that's it.
But I'm going to ask Andy one more question. Andy, you've been living with HIV for 22 years. You've been on ARVs since 2008. Are you ashamed of having HIV?
Not at all. That's why I'm standing here.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want us also at the end, at the end of the session, to honor the treatment activists, those whom we stigmatize, those whom we criminalize. And I want to ask the sex workers and those populations at risk of criminal laws, our own criminal stupidity, to come over and take over the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, as a gay white man, please come up, ladies and gentlemen. Take over the stage. Come and dance with Princess Mabel and with Mrs. Michelle. This conference to the sex workers, to the injecting drug users, to the migrants, to the African men who have sex with men, to the vulnerable, to the poor, and to the children. We can change the course of this epidemic with them. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Conference.